sixth race, and I'm pleased that we have all three candidates here tonight. So if I could have the candidates come forward, Amy Gibbs, Felix Vayner, and Ron Warner. So please join us up on the stage. Our next candidate for District 6 is Ron Borders.
Thank you, James. Good evening, and thank the AAUW for hosting this event. Thank you for attending to learn about the candidates, and thank all the candidates Let me tell you a little bit about myself and about my family. I'm married to Tammy. We have two daughters, Alex 28 and Mallory 26. Tammy's a graduate of Valdosta State University with a degree in nursing. I'm a graduate of Valdosta State University with a degree in Master's of Public Administration. Tammy and I work together in the real estate business. I've been involved in the community for 30 years. I've served on the city council for 10 years. I've served as your state representative to the Georgia General Assembly for 8 years. I've served as president or chairman of the Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors, the South Georgia Chapter of Military Officers Association of America, the Valdosta Chapter of Habitat for Humanity, and I'm a former Vietnam helicopter pilot. My business experience has largely been in the area of real estate. I believe that a real estate background is a valuable asset for someone making decisions that could affect most people's single most important investment in their life, and that is their home. That is why my platform, my reason for running is the preservation and protection of neighborhoods. I hope that you will ask me specific questions about my platform and how I intend to preserve and protect our neighborhoods, and how the protection and enhancement of our three largest economic engines dovetails and complements that platform. Thank you, and I yield the floor.
Compliment all of our audience members. These are some fantastic questions, and I apologize that we don't have a chance to get to all of them, but we will certainly get to as many as we can. So the questions again for all three of our candidates. First question I have from our audience is, what steps would you take to attract more tourism and tourist economy dollars to our area of South Georgia? So again, what steps would you take to attract more tourism and tourist economy dollars to our area of South Georgia? And we'll begin with Felix.
I've actually been working with a local business that's up and coming to provide transportation for local businesses to do food tasting around town, downtown, which I've heard in Thomasville and other cities. It is growing, thriving, and we're trying to do another implementation here with the Valdostas. We have so much to offer here, and there's so many restaurants and local businesses that are already on board that I think it would be a great success and benefit many small businesses and many other communities. Many small businesses.
First of all, I think we do a great job with our tourism and also attracting people to come here. We have people that we are friends with. They actually drive 35, 45 miles from here to come here to shop and to do their business because of what we have versus what they have. I think to increase our dollars is to work with what we've got in place. We do have a tourism department in place right now. I think they do a great job. We work with our Chamber of Commerce. I think they do a great job. The thing is that we just have to have a way of advertising more, I think, in the sense of allowing people to see exactly everything we have. And it's true, we do need more businesses in this area. But at the same time, we also need to make sure that everybody knows what we have. Not everybody understands every business we have and where they're at and what all we have available to them for right here in our community. So I really think that we do a great job at it, and we can definitely improve. That's definitely what we're doing.
Thank you. Okay. Felix, that's a good idea about that food. You know, I read a Gun Guard magazine in Southern Living, and each issue that you see in there, they've got an article about specialty food items and people coming to see those things. Ned, you've got a good idea about it. We have to get the message out. We've got a lot here that we have to get the message out. My focus would be on one thing that we've got to work with the city of Valdosta. We're not like San Antonio, where we've got a river running through it. We're not like Amelia Island, where we've got a beach. We're not like Blue Ridge, Georgia, where we've got a mountain people can come to. So what do we have? We've got the downtown. That's what we've got. We've got to work with the downtown. One way we can work with the downtown, and I can speak from experience, is that I've renovated buildings downtown, and I have offices down there. And then on the top, I've got people that live there. Another thing is to meld this university, right here, this university, with the downtown and infill that area with college-related businesses so that we become known as a college town instead of just a town with a college in it. Thank you.
Our next question from the audience, which I appreciate, is do you have any ideas to motivate VSU students to stay here in Valdosta after graduation and to grow job opportunities for them? So do you have any ideas to motivate VSU students to stay here in Valdosta after graduation and to grow job opportunities for them? And for our first response to that question, we'll start with Ian.
I think the first thing we need is, again, I think VSU does a great job. We all graduated, in my family, my wife actually works at VSU. She works in the alumni, she's the director of alumni association and everything. And so VSU is big on our map in the sense of promoting it and making sure that everyone knows about it. And the biggest thing that we talk about in our house is basically how do we get people to stay here? And the reason why is because if we mold them and educate them and then they leave and go to some other places, then of course that does not help us out. I think it starts with the businesses around here that do reach out to some students and give them opportunities to serve and to work as they go to school, but we also need to be able to reach out to them and give them opportunities to stay, to actually give them opportunities to grow and see that, hey, if I stay here, I can grow here. I'm not just here to get my education and then push me out the door. They're actually going to make a job for me. They're actually going to make a desk for me. So I think in those cases that would definitely help us in our economy, our VSU, be able to stay here where it needs to be at.
Thank you.
That's a real good question. And that has been a question that's laid out in this community for years. I said previously in my remarks that I served as chairman of the board of directors for the Chamber of Commerce. One reason I undertook that was to push through, finally, after 10 years, achieving an incubator, or as you may, a business accelerator for Valdosta, Georgia. That will be opening hopefully this year, and you'll hear an announcement of where it's going to be located. Now that's going to attract some people to stay here, not a lot, because there's not that many businesses that get to the point where they need to have all the professional office staff to develop their business. But what that will do will allow us to act as a recruiter for people to come here. Andy spoke about keeping people here, and I believe he also meant we should make it attractive for people to come here. One way that we can have people retain their occupation and their livelihood and their residency here is if we meld that distance between the downtown and the university with areas where people can start their own business, hopefully college-related business. Thank you.
Felix.
Andy did bring up a great point, and education is key. But we also need to get the city more involved with a lot of these local businesses. We need to show them that the city is behind them. Not these big corporates, but the local economy. Because more of our tax dollars stay here locally. And that just means that it's more money for us to grow as a whole, as one, together.
Our next question from the audience is, what actions would you take to increase security and decrease burglaries and break-ins here in the city of Valdosta? So what actions would you take to increase security and decrease burglaries and break-ins here in the city of Valdosta? And we'll begin with that.
That's a very good question, and I did say as part of my platform was to preserve and protect neighborhoods. What I had in mind is protected neighborhoods builds well with this question. There, let's just say that you live in Wood Valley, Old Wood Valley. There's three access points or choke points. What the city could do is put up cameras so that they can record the vehicles coming in and out of that area and make it known that there are video cameras there to record the passage of people. That way, if you go into that area, you know that you're going to have to leave via that same ingress, and that you could get your license plate number or your photograph taken as you are leaving. That's one way, is to go ahead and videotape our access or our choke points. The other way is to make people aware of the things that they can do to go ahead and secure their own domicile. And I think that these two things are a good start to protecting physically our neighborhoods. Thank you.
I was actually I recently purchased a home in Old Valley, and we've actually had a bit of break-ins into cars. So, and you know, I've noticed there's a app called My Neighborhood, and people have actually been very active in my neighborhood in Old Valley and posting and responding. But I feel like we should just get out and meet each other. Maybe have more community held events for other people, for everyone to meet the people that just moved in or the people that have been there for years. Because the better we know each other, the better we can support each other. And that way we can communicate with one another and say, oh, did you see this or did you see this? Because we can't just always rely on the police, which they're doing phenomenal job as it is, but we have to take action ourselves, not physically, but as in looking out for each other.
Ron brings up a great point about security cameras, about city putting them in. The thing about it is, though, that cameras cost a lot of money. It's not just like going to Walmart or Home Depot and just throwing a camera up. To have a camera, what they're talking about is thousands of dollars, which everybody now is going to complain about how we're going to pay for it, which I think is a good idea to do if we can afford it. However, though, how do we increase security is that we actually have to do it along with the police force, all of us. I mean, we all have to be the police, you know, our own community, our own neighborhood. You know, we can't see something happen and turn a blind eye and say, well, I don't want to get involved in that, I don't want to deal with that, I don't have time for that. See it, we need to stop it. You know, we need to say something, we need to do something about it. And yes, turn it over to the cops and let them handle it. But if we see something going wrong, we need to jot down that tag number or whatever, that house number, whatever it is, or make a phone call or call the neighbor, hey, man, I saw somebody around your house today. You might want to take a look at that. Now, as far as decreasing burglaries, that's the one way we do it. And we do it as a community and as a whole.
Our next question from the audience for all of the District 6 candidates is, what do you believe is the most important area that the city needs to improve in? So what do you believe is the most important area that the city of Valdosta needs to improve in? And we'll begin with Phoenix.
I think we need to improve in communication and community. I feel like if we get to know each other, if we know who our neighbors are, we can trust each other. We'll feel safer at home, because not only do we know our neighbors to the left and to the right, but we know who
growth of our community. As we've been saying all along, and, you know, we've got to keep people here. We educate. We've got a great education system, high school, middle school, elementary, all of it, even college. And, you know, so, but the thing about it is that if we have people who stay here and the growth of our economy, and through that, you also have the growth of our communities. And when you have the growth of our communities, then you have the growth of revenue, and then with revenue, you get many more things. You know, so, I mean, you know, the plan is to figure out how do we grow our economy without, you know, in a way, in a fashion of that everybody sees it as this is what we're doing for our community and not just about me. You know, so I think that's what we need to do first.
The most important thing that the city can do now is to increase the tax digest. The tax digest is the property basis upon which income is generated to run the city. The other revenue streams are the local option sales tax and the regular sales tax that we have. The millage rate upon which you pay your taxes is almost twice what it was when I previously served on the city council. The way you increase the tax base is make the community more attractive for employers to locate their factories here. Make the city more attractive so that businesses are willing to expand here. One way you can do that is to make the downtown a place that people want to come. That's all we've got to work with in the city as far as an amenity. Many of you have been to a large city in America. When you went to that large city, did you say to your spouse, honey, let's take the kids to the mall? You don't do that. You take them to what is unique and attractive about that city. And that's what we have to do, establish a downtown that is unique and attractive. Thank you.
Thank you. And our last question, our last question from the audience for the District 6 candidates is, how will you balance professional obligations with the position demands of serving on the city council other than attending the regular meetings? So how do you balance your professional obligations with the position demands of serving on the city council beyond attending the regular meetings? And we begin with Ian.
The way I will balance it is the way I've been doing it for the last 15 years. As I said before, I've been involved in a lot of things. I've been involved with boards, the Mayor of Council Disability. I've been involved with the education system. I started the Miracle League of Valdosta 14 years ago, which has taken us to the point where now we're doing that complex I told y'all about. The way you balance it is that you just got to make sure that you realize that you're serving the community and that you're there for them. You're not there for yourself. You're there to make sure that whatever decision you make is not going to benefit them. It is going to benefit them right now, but at the same time, it's set to where it benefits all their kids and grandkids as they come up. The biggest thing is it's not a matter of what we're going to do right now in the sense of what we're going to do now to prepare for this thing to last for a long time. And so I think with that, we just need to make sure that, you know, I need to make sure that when I win this seat, that I'll actually keep that in mind as I have for the last 15 years as being an educator and all the professions I've done.
Okay. Thank you.
That equation will become real germane if one of my daughters gets married and has a child, and my wife is going to take me to that city where those grandchildren are. Right now, my time is my time. Of all my companies, I have partners or managers that run those companies. I'm old enough to be able to say without embarrassment that I can work when I want and I can take off when I want. I generally go to work at 10 o'clock because I like to spend time at home, and I usually take off at 4 o'clock because I like to spend time at home. So I have a lot of free time. I can understand, now 30 years ago it wasn't that way when I had kids at home, but right now I have the time and the ability to devote to me.
I've actually owned a business for the past 7 years. Recently split the business into another, and we've grow. And unlike these two gentlemen, I don't have a family, which means that I can actually give this the time that it deserves and go above and beyond to do what is necessary and give all my time and effort to making sure that Valdosta is growing, that it's thriving, that it's expanding. I mean, everything that we see it moving forward.
Thank you. And we'll now have our wrap-up comments from the three candidates, and we will begin with Rod Waters.
I can't believe that a handsome fellow like Felix got to have a girlfriend, and he's probably getting one here as soon as he leaves. He married, got six kids, don't have time to do it. You find somebody else to talk about. Okay, let me answer some of the questions that were earlier, and I kind of like those, and I hope you bear with me. The roundabouts. Most of you have been to a big city somewhere, and you could go down here to Amelia Island. And if you've been around the roundabout four or five times, you know how easy it is to get in and out. But if you get in there with somebody that's never been there before, you wish you had never seen a roundabout. And that's probably the problem we're going to have here. It's going to take some learning and some getting adjusted to it. We can get adjusted to that. The other question was unemployment that kind of intrigued me. We have pretty much full employment for those who meet certain qualifications. The reason that we see a lot of people that can't get employed is because the state still has that old-fashioned thing, check the box. If you've ever jaywalked or backcalled somebody and you've got arrested by the police, you've got to check the box. Well, I've been working with somebody here, a local employer, to get the General Assembly to make that illegal to require somebody to check the box so these people who have made an innocent mistake can get a job. I'll leave the minority relations and Hispanic relations alone because I think they're doing real well here. Thank you.
Our next comments are from Felix Banner.
While building this campaign, I've heard people say, don't make any promises. Nevertheless, my father taught me never to make a promise I can't keep. But today, I'm going to make you a promise. I'm going to promise you to give 110% and be the best that I can be. When called upon to be fair and just with the utmost integrity in mind, this is what I can promise you today. And most have given you an idea of the person that I am and the values that I hold closest to me. Thank you so much for allowing me this opportunity.
And our next wrap-up comments are from Andy Gibbs.
First of all, once again, thank y'all for allowing me to come and speak to y'all. Next thing is that I hope after what you've heard tonight that and what I told you at the beginning of who I am and what I've done and what all I've done in this community and what all I continue to do. I hope I win this seat. I really do. I hope I win City Council District 6. And I'll do the greatest job I can do within the areas that I can do it. I'll treat it just like I would anything else, and I give it 100%. At the same rate, though, if somebody asks me one day, what if you don't win? Well, I'm going to keep serving on the board, the VLPRA. I'm going to keep going to church. I'm going to keep being an educator and educate students and make them smarter and better and brighter at Valdosta Middle School. I'm going to continue to do everything I'm doing. And I'm going to wish the other one the best and work with them. And that's the thing is that we got to make sure that no matter what, we keep our community at the eye of everything instead of worrying about how it can really affect me if I don't or if I do. And so, anyhow, if you live in my district, vote for me. If you don't live in my district, tell somebody else that does, vote for me.
My friends, please join me in thanking our